Today we are going to talk about handling conflicts in marriage. It has been said, marriage is made in heaven, but so are thunder and lightning. Not only marriage, but also thunder and lightning. Today, if you see in the family courts, there are more number of cases in the family courts. People want to separate themselves from each other. But for God's people, this should not be so. In fact, any Christian couple can, by God's grace, learn to dwell together in unity. That has been the prayer of Jesus Christ for the church, and it stands good for the families as well. In fact, even if just one partner can keep a conflict from happening, that is possible according to Proverbs chapter 15, verse 18. It says, a wrathful man stirs up strife, but he who is slow to anger allays contention. Even if one partner in the family wants to stay in marriage, God can help that person and God will help that person. But however, sometimes it is not possible. Sometimes even if one person is very, very good, the other person is not so, and therefore there are bound to be more problems and conflicts in marriage. Every exemplary Christian family can and must know how to biblically avoid and resolve conflicts with each other. Now, what is a conflict? First of all, I would say what it is not. We are not talking about having a difference of opinion with someone or disagreeing with someone. That is always there. Anywhere you go in the world, any family, because we are different. We are created different, different by design. John MacArthur has written a book on this title, Different by Design. And so we are not talking about the differences of opinions. We are bound to have a difference of opinion with someone and we disagree with people, but that's not conflict. Or we are not even talking about being offended or offending someone. These things can happen without conflict. What is the meaning of conflict? The word conflict comes from Latin derivation, and it means to strike. And it is a common military term which means to fight against. So conflict means to strike or to fight against. When two people have a conflict, they may have a physical or a verbal fight. Many times a verbal fight, and sometimes it happens even in the physical level as well. But both people are involved and they are against each other. That is conflict. So if you want to define a conflict, it would go something like this. Conflict is when both parties sin against one another in their communication and or their actions. It could happen in their communication and it also could happen in their actions. So conflict is when both parties sin against one another and are then in opposition to one another. They are in opposition to one another. In fact, there are unbiblical thoughts that hinder conflict solving. Maybe some of the thoughts that people have, we may talk about them. Number one, I will have my way. I can't believe he wants to paint the house green. Or why try? He won't even listen. I think many people say this. Why try? He won't even listen. He makes me so mad. He only cares about himself. He will never change. Or she, you know, impossible. She is impossible. It's no use. The problems are too big to solve. These are unbiblical thoughts that hinder conflict solving. I can't take the pressure, some people say. Some say, well, there is no hope at all. No hope in our marriage. Things will never get any better. Divorce is inevitable. Divorce is inevitable. These are self-serving and unbiblical justification for giving up and no longer trying to work through the problems. And instead of doing that, the Bible says we need to be transformed in our minds. First of all, transformed in our minds, according to Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Okay, let's talk about some biblical thoughts that enhance conflict solving. If there is a conflict, what are the biblical thoughts that enhance conflict solving? Number one, James chapter 1, verses 2 to 5, says, consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance, and let endurance have its perfect result, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. But if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all men generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. What do we learn here? We need to ask a question. What is God trying to teach me in the midst of this conflict? Now, conflicts do come, but this is the question that we need to ask. What is God trying to teach me in the midst of conflict? Going to 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10 and even 13, it says, but to the married I give instructions, not I, but the Lord, that the wife should not leave her husband. And verse 13 says, and a woman who has an unbelieving husband and he consents to live with her, let her not send her husband away. So the second thing that we need to look at is, I am a Christian. For me to initiate a divorce just because we are having a lot of conflict is not an option that I have. This is not an option for me as a Christian. Because Matthew chapter 19 verse 6 says, therefore what God has joined together, let no man separate. And therefore it is no option for us. And then number three, 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 13 says, no temptation has overtaken you, but such as is common to man. And God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will provide the way of escape also, that you may be able to endure it. You need to believe that God will help you to endure these conflicts. These are the biblical thoughts. And then 1 Peter 3:17 says, for it is better if God should will it so, that you should suffer doing what is right rather than for doing what is wrong. Meaning that if I must suffer through this conflict, I want it to be for doing what is right, not because I have sinned. I want to do right. Even if I suffer, no problem, but I want to do right. I want to do God's will. First Peter chapter 4 verse 19 says, therefore, let those also who suffer according to the will of God entrust their souls to a faithful creator in doing what is right. Now, I was told that almost all the couple, all of you are Christians. You declare your allegiance to Jesus Christ. And so, you want to do right, even if it means suffering for you. And Romans 8:28 says, for we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. That means God has a purpose in the conflict. God has a purpose in the conflict. We have a good example of Joseph in the Old Testament. Genesis chapter 50 verse 20. Joseph is speaking to his brothers who had sold him as a slave years earlier. This is what he said. As for you, no mincing of words. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about this present result. And Philippians chapter 2 verse 3 says, do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, let each of you regard one another as more important than himself. Now you need to ask here a question. What can I do differently to make it easier for us to solve this conflict? Everyone should ask this question. The husband or wife. According to one author by the name of Mack, he did his PhD dissertation on family. And this is what he said. There are basically three kinds of conflict. Three kinds of conflict. Number one is conflict over differentness. Now people have so many different ideas. They are different over the time they go to bed or the time they get up in the morning. Some people get up early, some people get up very late. And if the husband is a person who really wakes up in the night or spend much of his time in the night reading or doing something, and then gets up late and wife gets up in the morning, there is a problem. Or how to clean to keep the house, foods you like to eat. Even there are people who have a problem on way to squeeze the toothpaste tube. The people have problems, even such silly problems. Or whether to paint the living room blue or green. Well, differentness is not right, not wrong. It is neither right nor wrong. It is not sinful. So we can be different and we still don't have to fight. But if it is not differentness is if it is not handled properly, then it can culminate in sin. People get into conflicts. What is the solution for that? Ephesians chapter 4 verse 3 says, forbearing love. In other words, put up with the other person's, thinking. That is what Ephesians chapter 4 verse 3 says. Or sometimes, there are, people who don't leave their parents and cleave to their spouse, that's the problem. If the wife doesn't cleave, or the husband doesn't cleave, or leave the parents, their parents, and cleave to each other, then there is a problem. We talked about it yesterday so much. There are so many problems like that. So there is a differentness, and there is selfishness or sinfulness. Selfishness or sinfulness is another cause of conflict in marriage. Our natural heart wants to have our own way. My own way. I don't like to be told what to do. I'm the boss of my own life. I don't want anybody to tell me what to do, what not to do. We are naturally rebellious and selfish people. As a result, there is a conflict. And it may be because we are too selfish. And the conflict then results in angry outbursts, pouting, manipulating, nagging, or resentment. So many things like that. The third reason people have conflict is because of righteousness. People can have conflict because of righteousness? Yes. A conflict over righteousness occurs when one partner believes the other is violating the moral will of God as revealed in Scripture. For example, the way you rear your child, or should we watch movies or we don't watch movies? Should we not watch movies? What kind of books we can read, or what kind of books we should not read, we should not have in our house? Television programs, which one to watch, which one to avoid? Or obvious areas of, such as truth telling, moral purity, and not profaning God's word. Some people use OMG so quickly, Christians. It's a blasphemy. Do you use your mother's name like that? We don't use our mother's name like that as a cuss word. But we use God's name. And so there are problems like that. And now the solution to conflict over righteousness is for both partners to submit to the word of God in that matter. So there are various types of conflicts that happen over various things. And what are the attitudes that we need to have to solve conflicts? Holier than thou attitude. I am always right, you are always wrong. That kind of attitude will work? No. Ephesians chapter 4 verses 1 to 3. Talks about at least four things. Number one, humility. Now, if people are humble, then you can solve so many problems. Actually, problems come because we are not humble. We are so proud. We always think that we are right. And even if we are wrong, even after knowing we are wrong, we don't want to submit to that. We don't want to confess that we are wrong. In fact, the Bible says that we begin our Christian life with humility. Matthew chapter 5 verse 3 says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit," not the poor physically, but poor in spirit, "for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." In the Greek, second part is so emphatic that it can be translated as, "Theirs alone is the kingdom of heaven." Not everyone is going to heaven, but those people who have a humility of heart are attitude of humility, they will be accepted by God. Now, if you want to illustrate it, you know, the illustration, you can take it from the New Testament itself. Two people went to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee, you know that story, and the other was a tax collector. Who was accepted and declared righteous? It was the tax collector. Because he had that poverty of spirit in him. He was so desperate. He said, God, be merciful to me, the sinner. So that's how you start your Christian life. And we continue in that same spirit. Now, if only people are humble at home and in the church or in the society, I think we will not have so many conflicts. Everyone wants to have his own way or her own way. We don't want to be humble. We are so proud. But the Bible says God resisted the proud and giveth grace to be humble. God becomes an enemy. That's the Greek word. He becomes your opponent. God becomes enemy to those who don't have humility. In fact, the humility that is used in Ephesians is tapeno phrosune, which is two words put together, which means lowliness of mind. Lowliness of mind. In fact, John Wesley of England, he said there was no such word among the Greeks and the Romans. They did not have a word, humility, that kind of tapeno phrosune was not there in their dictionaries. It was a bad word for them, but for us it is a good word. And we begin our lives and we continue our lives and we should end our lives with humility. So if we develop humility, a lowliness of mind, humble ourselves before God, God will show grace to us, unmerited favor in our lives. You're not going to lose anything by becoming humble. If you are not humble, you're going to lose everything. And therefore, we need to develop that lowliness of mind or humility in our lives in order to solve conflict. Number two, gentleness. This is needed for us to solve the conflicts. Gentleness. Gentleness is not weakness, but it is a strength. But strength under control. Now, I can use my mouth to destroy the other person, and I can use the same mouth or same tongue to build up the other person. I can control my mouth. I can control my hands. By the way, you know, most of the time it is the men who abuse their wives, and some men beat their wives very badly. Because they are strong. I read in one book that men have 50% more brute strength than women. And that's why they use that brute strength wrongly. No, that's not the way to solve the problems. In fact, even in the church elders should not solve the problems with their fist. With their hand. You need to control your strength. Strength under control is called gentleness. Even women, in fact, it is supposed to be the adornment of a woman. According to 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 4. And the Bible says it is precious in the sight of God. And gentleness is a part of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And we need to pursue gentleness, the Bible says. My friends, these are actually simple. You don't have to complicate them. If only we can have these attitudes in our lives, we can solve the problems, and if we can avoid even the problems. Gentleness. And the third one, patience. There are two Greek words for patience in the New Testament. One is hupomone. Hupomone is being patient under difficult circumstances, such as the loss of a job, loss of a child, or a spouse, or, you know, ill health. You are patient, or you can bear that difficult situation. But there is a second one that's called makrothumia. Makrothumia is being patient with difficult people. Now, we are called upon by the Lord. If you are a Christian, directly, this is for you and for me. We need to have patience. We need to be patient with difficult spouse. Colossians 1:11 says, strengthened with all power according to his glorious might for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience. Patience pays. Now, if you are quick in your judgment and you don't want to, be patient with a difficult person in your life, then the problem is you will feel sorry after some time. And by then it is too late. Patience is so good unless there is a danger for your life. If your husband or wife is trying to kill you, then you must get away from that person because life is more precious. But otherwise, being patient, the Bible, says patience is the fruit of the Spirit. And patience is good. And we need to have this kind of attitude to solve the problem, patience. You don't solve the problem overnight. Many problems are not solved like that. We develop any problem over many, many days or months or years sometimes. And it is not easy to solve the problem so easily. Because two sinners, even though they are saved by the grace of God, they still have indwelling sin in them, and therefore it is difficult. And so you have to bear with the person. Number four, forbearance. Forbearance involves self-restraint and putting up with another. Forbearing love, it also says, so forbearing love. This is the love that covers the sin of others. When somebody has confessed to that sin, don't bring that up again and again. Cover it. Forbearing love does that. Even though many times we are taken for granted and people take us for lightly, but still forbearing love takes all that and continues to love. Now tell me, my friends, if we have this kind of attitude, don't you think that our families would be so nice, so wonderful, so blessed? And we will become a blessing to others? Definitely. Okay, let me go into another issue, that is, what does God think of conflict? What does God think of conflict? Number one, it grieves God. In the same passage, God wants harmony among God's children. He says, the Holy Spirit of God gives the unity, and you have to protect the unity. Let me read that portion from Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, it says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Endeavoring to keep. The word endeavoring here is a Greek word that is used to talk about holy zeal and enthusiasm to keep the unity. We need to have that holy zeal and enthusiasm to be united as husband and wife. And therefore, if it doesn't happen, it grieves God. He wants his children to live in harmony. And what does God think of conflict? The Bible says, you know, don't offend people unnecessarily. Don't give offense to anyone, to the Greeks, or to the Jews, or to the Church of God. Don't give offense to anyone. And, you know, the Bible says that God sees anger as equal to murder. If you are angry over your brother for no reason, and you say all kinds of things, and which is very, very normal in many families. They speak so bad words and so cutting words, so destructive words, that God sees them as murder, equal to murder. How to avoid conflicts? How to avoid conflicts? There are some sinful ways to avoid conflicts, and there are God-honoring ways to avoid conflicts. First of all, let's avoid conflicts, first of all. Why do you get into conflicts and then resolve the conflicts? Avoiding is better. So, what are some sinful ways to avoid conflicts? Yesterday, I think some of us were saying this. Just keep quiet. Just keep quiet. Or stay away from one another. You don't like? You want to avoid the conflict? Stay away from that person. Or change the subject. You know, I have references for all these things, and they are all sinful ways to avoid conflicts. Hide information or hide sins or bitterness. That's also not the right way. But there are God-honoring ways to avoid conflicts. Number one, seek to know your spouse well. Appreciate him or her and understand his or her perspective. Let's read 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7. 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 7 says, husbands, likewise, dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. Try to understand your spouse well and appreciate your spouse and understand your spouse. That's a God-honoring way of avoiding conflict. Number two, gather plenty of data before speaking. The Bible calls him a fool who doesn't listen, but he wants to speak before listening. So that's not right. Gather plenty of data before speaking. Number three, pray, study, and think about the issue before speaking if possible. Proverbs chapter 15, verse 28. Pray and study or think about the issue before speaking if possible. Number four, demonstrate and or communicate your love and care at the time of your disagreement. Even when you disagree, demonstrate your love. Communicate your love. Romans chapter 12, verses 9 to 10. Listen more than you speak, but do speak. Listen more than you speak, but do speak. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 19 and 25, verse 11. In matters of sin, approach your wife or husband in love. If he has sinned or she has sinned, approach in love. Ephesians 4, 15. You have to speak the truth, but truth in love. Colossians 3, 19 as well. In matters of preference, prefer your spouse. Romans 12, verse 10. Prefer your spouse in matters of preference. In matters of wisdom and conscience, suggest searching the scriptures and getting godly counsel. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 14. Refuse to sin in your communication. Refuse to sin in your communication. In fact, in our communication, we fall into so many problems. Most of us do not follow the biblical principles of communication. Let me just give you a few principles of communication from the Bible. I have references for all of them, but because of the brevity of time, I am not going into all of that. Be ready. Be a ready listener and do not answer until the other person has finished talking. That we talked about. Be slow to speak. Think first. Don't be hasty in your words. Speak in such a way that the other person can understand and accept what you say. Don't go to bed angry. Do not use silence to frustrate the other person. Do not become involved in quarrels. Do not respond in uncontrolled anger. When you are in the wrong, admit it and ask for forgiveness. And ask how you can change. When someone confesses to you, tell him or her you forgive him or her. Be sure it is forgiven and not brought up to the person, to the others, or to yourself. Avoid nagging. Do not blame or criticize the other person. If someone verbally attacks, criticizes, or blames you, do not respond in the same manner. Now, we have so many references for all these things. Try to understand the other person's opinion. Be concerned about the interests of others. So many things like this. Be more interested in God's glory and the other's good rather than having your own way or being right. Is God glorified in this matter? Does it serve the purpose of bringing good to others? We have to look into that. So then now, these are some ways that you can avoid conflict, and that honors God. This is, if you follow this way, it honors God. You bring glory to Him. And when you bring glory to Him, you are satisfied. There is a great blessing of God upon your life and your family. But suppose you get into the conflict. What do we do biblically? How to resolve conflicts? Now, some simple ways to resolve conflicts. Number one, let time heal it. It doesn't do that. Try to bury it. No, that's not the right way. Pretend it never happened. Pretend it never happened. Even though these things are happening, pretend as if these things are not happening at all. Wait for the other person to initiate the resolution process. Should I always, start this process? Let me wait for the other person. Let her come back to me or let him come back to me. These are not the right ways of conflict resolution. Punish the other person until they change and take all the blame. Yes, I am wrong, like that, That's wrong. Is there a biblical way to resolve conflict? Yes, there is a biblical way. And let me give you this one and I close. Number one, confess any sin that you are aware of to God. Have you not sinned in this conflict? Confess it, first of all. Whoever you are, husband or wife, confess any sin that you are aware of, first of all, to God, because you have sinned against God. Any sin is a sin ultimately against God. And therefore, you have to go to God for cleansing. Confess it. And then number two, go to your spouse and ask for forgiveness for each thing you did specifically, and discuss your plan not to do those things again. That's a wonderful statement. For each thing that, you know, don't say, okay, if I am wrong, please forgive me. Don't say like that. Go to your spouse and ask for forgiveness for each thing you did specifically, and discuss your plan not to do those things. And then number three, express a desire to resolve the conflict fully and decide together when the best time to do that would be. There is a best time and there is a worst time. So you need to express a desire to resolve the conflict fully and decide together when the best time to do that would be. Number four, come together at the appointed time. Don't delay. Don't take 10 days, you know, or many days like that. Pray together for God's wisdom, self-control, and speech. And now all these have biblical warrant. Review God's rules of communication. Now, I have already given you God's rules of communication. Review them before you speak or you resolve the problem. Each one should take a turn to confess any sin that has not been confessed to God and spouse and ask for forgiveness. Begin discussing the issues that precipitated the conflict. Decide what you can agree upon. Decide what you do not agree upon. Decide what kind of issue you are dealing with. Is it a preference issue? Is it a sin issue? Is it a conscience issue? Is it a wisdom issue? There are several types of issues. Decide on specific steps to resolve the issue. And together begin carrying out the appropriate steps to resolve the issue. Decide if and when you need to discuss the issue again. End your time together with prayer and expression of love. Prayer, begin with prayer and then end with prayer with expression of love. James chapter 3, verses 13 to 18, I will read and just close with that. James chapter 3, verses 13 onwards. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy, good fruits, without partiality, and without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray that you will impress these truths about conflict resolution in our hearts so deeply. Help all of us that we may avoid conflicts in a God-honoring manner. And if we do get into trouble and conflict, help us that we may follow the biblical guidelines as you've given to us in your word. Bless us, Father, for the rest of the time as well as we spend time in question and answer and in other ways. We pray, Father, that you will be glorified in all this. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Amen.